Et ça. Now everything is working when I came on here before, and now it's acting crazy. Give me 2 minutes, Jazz. Oh my God. Okay, everybody, I have been experiencing some technical difficulties. I do not like that. I can't do my intro. I can't do my opening. But welcome, everybody, to the BRI, right? Which is the Black Research Institute. My name is Denegus Denoris Wilson. So once again, welcome, everybody, to the BRI, the Black Research Institute, and I limit it to Sky. See, I try to merge entertainment with information, and the icing on the cake is a dope conversation. Ain't no time for the faking, debating, or the hating. I'm trying to hip you all to the moves they be making. They all struggle, but still find a way to make a way. Fight back, count stacks, stay black all day. So I seek to supply you all with inspiration, with information to remedy our present situation. By showing you examples of black royalty, and you never have to question my intent or loyalty, we're moving forward with the strength that's supremely kinetic, confident, black, unapologetic, instilling self-love with what really we hope. No doubt about it, black people, we dope. And tonight is no different. I have a dope individual, a dope lady that is an entrepreneur, go-getter. She is now into the world of cannabis. So now you're gonna know her name, but for me, she is Griselda Blanco of the cannabis world. And if you know, you know. So since I'm experiencing technical difficulties, the normal spree that I go through, I'm not going to be able to go through tonight. So I'm going to bring my guests in and we're going to make it happen. So everyone, please welcome the highly sedity LLC entrepreneur, Miss Jasmine Cross. Hey, Jazz.
Hi, how are you?
I'm doing good. And yourself?
I'm good. I can't complain. Not at all.
Let's not even fake like we wasn't in the back green room
talking. Right?
Like we was already back to talking. We trying to act like we just now seeing each other. We don't talk about 10 minutes. But it's customary here on the BRI before we actually start the interview that I ask you two questions.
Okay.
Are you ready?
Absolutely.
Okay. So the first question is, are you being safe?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. All right. The next question is, are you happy?
Yes.
You are?
Yes.
That's all we need to do. So that's it. So I don't know you personally. I met you online. I saw you in the hemp industry. We talked a little bit and I told you I wanted to come on the show and we kept missing each other as far as the times and everything. So I don't know you. The people looking don't know you. So tell the people a little bit about Jasmine.
Okay. So my name is Jasmine. I am born and raised in New York City, in Hollis, Queens.
Did you know Run DMC?
My dad did. And okay. I really, we're all like from the same, because we're all from the same neighborhood. Hollis is really like a small family. So Chris Run, which is Jam Master Jay's brother, I believe, like his birthday party was like last Sunday. So I went to that and it was like a whole bunch of Hollis people. So it's like, once you're from Hollis, everybody kind of knows each other because everybody kind of stays in the neighborhood. Like my grandmother still lives in Hollis. I don't, but my grandmother does. And my best friend, I'm constantly over there. Okay. So I didn't know them personally, no, but my dad did.
Okay. A lot of people came from Hollis, man.
Yeah.
LLJ.
Yep, LL, Ja Rule. I actually saw Ja Rule's daughter the other day. Because his wife is like really good with my boyfriend's cousin, so they're always around. Run DMC. My family's actually in the music industry, so there's always somebody lingering, or there was growing up. So yeah, I'm like, I played basketball growing up. I was a tomboy growing up, I was a nerd.
Okay.
So I went on to Howard University and I actually wanted to be a science teacher. So I was a biology major. I'm into science. And then I looked up and was like, I don't want to work for anybody else.
Okay.
I went to a college counselor and she was like, what would you do that you didn't have? If you weren't getting paid, what would you still do? And I was like, oh, I would do hair. So I switched to business. Then I went to cosmetology school. I landed in corporate America, which I absolutely hated. I have another business that I opened about 6.5 years ago. So I was doing that. Excuse me. And then I got into the hemp industry. And I literally went from dating the hustlers to becoming one myself. But
Griselda.
So it was a blessing. Like, things just kind of came together as far as the hemp industry goes. So that's a little bit of my story.
Yeah, don't give them to me. We got an hour. Like, we have an hour. Don't give them everything right now. We have
So that's just me in a nutshell.
Okay, so I want to ask you this. Okay, you said everything kind of came together as far as the hemp industry is concerned. What are some of the, like, hurdles that you have to overcome to even get in the industry? Like what if I wanted to get in the hemp industry, what would be the steps that I would need to take to even, you know?
Well, you can go about it
legally. I'm talking legally. I'm not.
Yeah, so you can go about this a few different ways, right? Because now they have like MLM companies that you can join. They have companies that you can actually start a CBD company, then you don't have any product, which I get it, but I don't get it because unless it's a very reputable company, where's your product coming from? And that was my biggest concern, was to make sure that I knew exactly where my product was coming from. Like, I didn't want to just pay a distributor in China to send me something and it could be synthetic. You don't know. So you definitely want to, you can get in through MLMs, you can get in through people doing drop shipping, or I also offer an affiliate program where my affiliates come in, I teach them all about the business, how to break down their product, move their product, licensing, banking, because banks are a big issue in this industry as well, because it's still not on the federal level. I also teach you how to develop your own brand and your own line of product. Our manufacturer can start your own line for you. They do as well if you would like them to. Mm-hmm. And that's how, through me, that's how you would get in. But there are quite a few ways to get in. So it's usually MLM, somebody you know, or somebody advertising that they're doing drop shipping, I would just say be mindful with both that you are getting quality grade A, CBD, CBG, THC, Delta-8, or whichever lane you're going to go.
Okay, so when you got into it, first of all, what made you get into it? Like, what was the catalyst for you to say, I want to try this?
So, like I said, I dated the drug dealers. So I like quick money. And I was like on Instagram, and there was a lady, and she had pictures of like 10 pounds of the flower. And I'm like, she's selling cannabis? And it sparked my interest. So I started doing some research, and then things just kept coming. It took me about a year and a half to get into the industry because nobody wanted to let me in on the level I wanted to get in. I wanted to get in on the farm level, to where I was on a farm, I worked on the farm, I was able to understand the growing process, see the growing process, and be very hands-on with the product and the quality. And there aren't a lot of us in the industry. At least there weren't. We're coming up now, but in the, like, 2 years ago, we weren't really in the forefront of this at all. We're still not in the forefront, or at least in the running. So a black farmer bought me in.
Nice. So look, I have a felony. Mm-hmm. Could I get in the hemp industry?
So it does depend on your state as far as those regulations go. Now, you may not be the owner of the company. You may just be a worker of the company. And it also depends on what they have. So usually THC and because that's considered a controlled substance, there will be some red flags with that. But that just means that you may not be hands-on with the flower. But you can absolutely do other things. So that's more state to state, depending on what their regulations are.
So you actually been to a farm?
I used to work on one right here in New York. It's 6 hours away from my house. Yeah, black girls, we're up on the farm. Yeah. So I used to take a lot of footage and put a lot of footage up on Facebook of me on the farm because I knew nobody would believe it, right? Because I don't look like I belong on a farm. To the point, like I said, a black farmer put me on. And when we would go places, I was never a partner. I was always his wife. And he would correct people like, she's not my wife. Because people just you don't see this, right? And I don't go up there looking raggedy. Like, I go up there looking cute. And it's like, now I might change my clothes. But, you know, I don't just look rugged and dirty. So yeah, I worked and I would go up. Some days I would literally drive up and turn right back around, do what I had to do and come back down. Some days I would stay up there because the farm had a house as well. So yeah, because I wanted to know all different aspects of the business.
Was it a big farm?
So it's 18 acres. There are 40 greenhouses. There's a natural spring on the farm, so it produces its own water, a source of water. There's a full hydration system as well. We also have outdoor crops, which it's tough doing that in New York because we have winter. So right. You have to be very careful. You know, you're going to lose the crop at some point when the winter comes in. So that's why it's great to have indoor. With indoor, you can actually manipulate the environment that the plants are in.
So in this, the farm that you are, I don't want to say own, but partner with, right? Uh-huh. Like, do they have like different strands of the flower?
Yes, they do. So our most popular ones are Bubba Kush, Sour Candy, and CBG.
Okay, now, but you say hemp, so that gets me to thinking that you are more geared toward the medicinal side of it.
Well, so THC, recreational THC just became adult. Let me clear that up. Adult recreational THC just became legalized in New York this year in 2020. So because that just became legalized, we're still waiting for all of the licensing to go through. Because they're actually starting a cannabis program here in New York. And Cuomo was trying to make it so that minorities were able to be in the footing, in the running. Because what happens in this industry is by the time we get to the table, you're getting scraps. You didn't feast on the entree like all of the big wigs did. So they just legalized that here. So we're still waiting on that licensing. So we haven't started growing THC on that farm as of yet. Now, I do have connections because I'm always on the West Coast doing business. So we have connections on the West Coast for when that does happen, we can just roll right on into it without it being an issue. But then you have Delta 8 gets you buzzed. So because Delta 9 is what the THC. THC is what gets you high. That's the psychotropic component of cannabis. So THC is the Delta 9 is what they're looking for when they drug test you. Right. Okay. So when they drug test you, they're usually specifically looking for Delta 9. And I can get all into the science, but it's a lot. So Delta 9 is here. Delta 8 is one step below it. But Delta 8 has not been regulated in a lot of jobs, drug testing in a lot of states as of yet. So a lot of people are, I guess you could kind of say under the radar with Delta 8, but Delta 8 gets you high as if it was Delta 9. So like the gummies we have are Delta 8 gummies. So okay. Those are not for children, 18 and over. It's more like 21 and over, really. But we have those. They also have Delta 8 that you can smoke in like a blunt form. I'm not too hip on that. Because you have to make, for me, you don't want anything that's been sprayed down. And that can cause an issue because now they're starting to make all kinds of synthetic things that go on your plants. So.
Yes, yes. So with you don't sell the flower. You sell like the candies, the gummies. And
no, I sell the flower. I have like pounds of flour. I sell the flour too.
What?
Yeah, because okay. I make my own oils. From the flower. And then with my affiliate program, they're allowed to move flour as well, like just loose flour. So yeah, we have flour.
So if there's no THC in the flour, what good is it?
So basically CBD, think of it like a baby, right? So where the mom is pregnant and instead of it being 9 months, which is THC, you extract the baby at like 7 months. So that would be considered CBD. So it's pretty much the same thing. You just don't let it go as long, right? And it depends on the seeds and things like that. But CBD has a lot of health benefits as well. So it can get you buzzed, especially if you, because so we have something called boutique flower. Boutique flower is expensive. So boutique flower is, it has a deeper effect, right? So CBD may make you relaxed. It may take away your anxiety. It's great for inflammation. It's great for people to have Crohn's disease, arthritis. If you've had any type of hip replacements or anything like that, any type of inflammation in your body, CBD can be used for. The farmer's mom had cancer. We put her on a strict alkaline diet plus CBG with no chemo or radiation. She is cancer-free. So yeah, there are a lot of health benefits to it. Children that have ADHD, children that are autistic, things like that.
Okay. So with the CBD industry, because it's like three different industries that come out of one flower, right? Like, yes. Like that come out of flower. Like you have the CBD, you have the hemp. Mm-hmm. And then you just have the cannabis, right?
Yes. And they all are derived from a hemp plant.
A hemp plant. That's what I'm saying. So I was looking into getting my own toilet paper company, right? I was going to start my own toilet paper company. And I wanted to use hemp. Like, I want to use hemp.
Yeah.
Because it's biodegradable and it's easily farmed. Right. Like it's easily farmed. So I wouldn't, I won't be chopping down a lot of trees.
Right. So hemp is actually one of the world's oldest natural resources. It's used for many different things. They even, at one point, the Native Americans used to make jeans out of hemp or pants out of hemp. I don't know if we would have called them jeans back then. There are airlines that are actually looking into using hemp to fuel their planes as well in the future. Yeah. Like, hemp is a big deal. That's why I try to tell people that look like us, if you're going to get in, you get in now. Even if you don't know what you want to do in the industry, you get in now, because when you start to see so many different industries jump on something, to me, it just makes sense for you to get in. Like, how many of us wish we could have bought Amazon when it was like $20? Right. So same thing with CBD. CBD and hemp. If you can get in now and get your foot in the door, like I was explaining, because my affiliates, we usually meet once a month. My schedule just got really hectic lately, but we usually meet once a month. So what I was explaining to them was, during the Olympics, there were quite a few athletes that came out and said that they use CBD during their training season. And I was like, could you imagine if a gold medalist was using your products and was able to endorse your products? And that's really, I don't want to say that's how simple it is, but it's really that simple. Like, if you have a decent product or you have a great product and you can get a training athlete to use it during training season, if they became a medalist, yes, that's a major deal, you know? So, and then people,
they become a medalist, and when they get their gold medal, they fire up a spliff on a podium.
Well, I guess it depends. Like, there was a soccer player who, her sister has a CBD company, so she came out and said that she used it. And this was around the same time that the young lady got banned from her first meet for using cannabis. Now, the difference with that is the soccer player never said how she consumed it, right? Because there's so many different ways to use cannabis. You can use, because like I said, it's for children as well. We don't ever recommend children smoking. So it could be gummies. It could be cream. My mom makes I actually put my mom onto the CBD industry. I was looking for the jar that she has. My mom makes a CBD body butter that we use on our site as well. So there's so many different ways to go about this. Because think about it, if you're a soccer player, your knees usually can be inflamed, your calves, your muscles, and your legs. So if you can use oils or something, that's still using the product, but you just didn't. It's a topical. You didn't ingest it. So there's so many ways for this to be used. It's really crazy.
Well, I had a friend. I have a friend. He's in Boston. His name is Kenneth Sparks. And he trains kids. And the kids kept getting like inflammation in their knees and joints. So he made his own butter. Like, he made up his own butter. And I didn't believe him. Hold on. I didn't believe him. And he sent it to me, right? Okay. He sent it to me. And because my knees, I have bad knees. Like, if I run too much, my knees will swell up. And my knees hurt. And I put that stuff on my knees. And I didn't think it was going to work. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't, but it does. It really does. Like, so
a lot of people think that, right? A lot of people are like, oh, it's not going to work. It's not like Ben Gay or anything like that. Same thing happened. Something very similar happened to my mom. She was doing like a farmer's market. And this lady came over to her and was like, I've been looking for you. So my mom is like a nervous Nelly. So she was like, oh my God, like, why is this lady looking for me? And the lady came over to tell her, like, she had had either knee or hip, a knee or a hip replacement. And her physical therapist was talking about how her inflammation was down so much and it had never been down like that. But she came to my mom to tell her that one of her friends bought a jar of her CBD butter and gave it to her. And that's what she started using. So there are a lot of benefits. There are actually a lot of physicians that are getting ready to add CBD into their patients' daily regime. So,
hey, listen, when the floodgates open, like when the floodgates open, like,
yes,
because what we at now, like 24 states that's legalized.
I want to say, I think so. Now CBD is legal in all states. CBD is legal in all of the states in the United States. Now, THC, yes, they're jumping on board. But from what we're hearing, they are projecting that by the end of next year, going into 2023, all of the states should be legalized.
Listen, when that happens, can you imagine seeing a cannabis commercial?
Well, if you start noticing, it's in a lot more movies now, right? Like, I just saw on Halloween, I had watched Candyman. Okay. And there's a scene in there with where they indulge. So it is becoming more of a social norm now. But yeah, you're going to see it because there are CBD commercials now all over the place. So you're going to see it. And it'll just be interesting to see how they advertise it, because that's still an issue, is the advertising. And I can't wait for the federal government to, you know, get on board with the banks, because that is one of the biggest hiccups, is banking and finding a bank that you don't have to jump through loopholes to get. And your money gets taxed. Oh my gosh, it's astronomical on the THC side. The THC side here in New York is about 18% that you're being taxed on your business.
What? And see, this is the thing. This is what I tell people. The reason why they are so slow in rolling out it nationwide is they trying to figure out how they're going to get the money.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Right. Because like with cigarettes, there's a seal. You have a seal on there, mm-hmm. right? And each seal is worth a certain amount of taxable dollar. Right. That's cigarettes are tax crazy, right? It's a seal. But if you don't have a company that boxes pre-rolls up, because if you notice, most pre-rolls, they have them in jars and they single. Uh-huh.
Right. Well, you know, because most people make them, right? So you just get like a pound of flour and then you break it up as you need to. But you're absolutely right. That is a major thing, is them trying to figure out how to regulate it. And then what they're also going to start doing, which a few states have already started doing, is they're going to limit the amount of dispensaries that are allowed in each state. So it won't be 70 something dispensaries, or it won't be, okay, I just want to look up and open it. Like here in New York, to open up a dispensary, the application fee is $10,000, and that's non-refundable. And then the license is about,
you get your money back.
You don't get your money back. So you can get denied, and they will keep the $10,000. And then the actual license is another $250,000. Then you have to have a location on hold with your lease for, I believe it's 3 years, unless they've changed it, right? So you have to have a lease for 3 consecutive years. And then you have to have $1 million on reserve. That's here in New York.
Yeah. Why though? Why? I know why. Right. I definitely know why. Like, I know why, but that's crazy, because that automatically stops minority entrepreneurs from even getting into
that. And right, that's why Cuomo was trying to build this program to make sure that it was inclusive. Now, whether that was the truth or not, I can't speak on that. I can only speak on what I've read, which is that he was trying to make things inclusive. Now, what would be smart is if people joined forces, and if you came together, you might have a better chance, because you need somebody that has a little status behind them. I know two doctors who got denied, and they have their own farmland. They got denied to open a dispensary. They're married to each other, so they have a couple million just on the side, right? Two Black doctors that went to Howard. They got denied, and then when they went back and looked at who made the cut for the dispensaries, it was all former police officers, former authority figures, former people in the political pool, because these are the people, because they understand the price points here, right? They understand the kind of money that they're going to make. So yeah, that's why I need my people. I need Black people to get in this. Like, and I'll tell you guys a little secret. Like I said, I was up on that farm, and sometimes we would tote loads of 100 pounds of flour, right, for one order. And we used to work with these guys who are billionaires. Their company's called Dr. Greens. They make hemp cigarettes. And we used to, it was 100 pounds of flour a week going up to Niagara Falls, right? You cannot move flour from upstate without the people of downstate. And who's downstate? The minorities. Well, we're not even minorities, but the urban community, right? You can't move certain product without it. And we believe that's why they even wanted the Black farmer on board, because they need us. They need us. They need us to move the product, because flour has an expiration on it. Flour, I teach people how to preserve flour, but after a while it gets dried up because it's a plant. It's a living thing. It's a plant. It's dried out, but it's still a plant. So they need our community. They just don't want to let us in to make the big bucks like they do.
You know, that's the only, like, to me, like any other entrepreneur endeavor you want to get into, any other one, like startup is not that expensive.
No.
Right? It's just not that expensive. And almost $500,000 just to get in.
Just to get in. Yeah. So that's why I
you would think broke on the application.
But that's just New York, right? So there are other states where it won't cost nearly as much money. It'll be much easier to do the licensing and things like that. New York is just, they're greedy for everything in New York. So that was the other reason why I'm looking to relocate as well. But yeah, if you can look up your state regulations and things like that, because you don't really have to have a dispensary either. It's a lot of stuff that comes with that too, right? Licensing and insurance and things like that. You can literally just have a CBD company and move your product the way you want to move it. And you're just considered like a store instead of a dispensary, right? And I keep telling our people, everybody watches Power and BMF and all these shows, and you want to push product. You can make money in this industry without ever touching product. Right. Okay, and let me tell you how you do that. You do that by understanding the accounting side of this. We need Black accountants in this industry that understand the ins and outs and taxes, okay? We need people that make labels. We need manufacturing companies for Black businesses that want to start their own CBD company, right? And the labeling and things like that. So you want to get into that. You want to, if you're into electrical work, farms still need electricity, right? So they need irrigation systems. If that's your lane and that's your niche, do that because there's a lot of work that has to be done behind the scenes with you never even touching product that you can make really good money on. And I mean really good, especially the labeling part. Oh my gosh, it's so hard to find somebody that understands the labeling side of this.
What you mean, like to have the ingredients and all that stuff,
right? Because so in order for you to be in an actual store, like a brick and mortar, a physical store. I mean, any store should have it like online too, but especially if you're in a physical location, you need to have the ingredients listed. You need to understand milligrams if you're doing tinctures and things like that, and you're not working with a lab, which you really should be working with a lab because that can be costly as well. You also want to have what's called a COA. And a COA basically is a barcode that can be scanned and it says where the flower came from, the farm that it was on. It gives you the breakdown and the percentages of how much THC is in it, how much CBD is in it. It tells you all about your flower or where the product came from. And you want to have that on there. You want to have warning labels on there as well. If it's 15, you know, I mean, not 15, sorry, if it's 21 and over. Like, there's so many different lanes here, right? So people have to be very educated when it comes to that. And you'd be surprised how many people don't know that. So the little stickers that go on like the Mylar bags, I thought I had one right next to me. But even if you had that, people always want to customize their stuff. So if you could do print, you could print stickers for people. There's so much money here. I mean, it's crazy.
Hey, that's what I do. I just read somewhere that they just up the amount of of flour you can get from a dispensary in DC now. You can get up to a half a pound.
Really? Wow. Wow. Which is interesting. I have to go read that because the last time we visited DC, it was the whole how they couldn't charge you for flour. They kind of had to like gift it or donate it to you.
Right.
Because again, there are a bunch of loopholes here, right? So it was like you would go into a store and a white t-shirt that you know is like $2-3, they would charge you the price of an eighth. So it would be like 34, 40, 60, whatever. And it would be like, here's your shirt and your free gift. and I'm not mad at them. I'm not mad at them because even one thing I will say in this industry is I'm not going to fool you all as if racism is not a part here, right? Because it is. Because they don't want us in the industry making the kind of money that they make. However, you will meet some melanin deprived folk in this industry that will keep it all the way 100 with you and let you know, like, yo, your struggle in the industry is my struggle, right? Having issues with banking, having issues with lending, having issues with getting your product out without being flagged, without being censored and things like that. That is across the board. It's not a Black people thing. That is across the board. Like, everybody has that issue in this industry.
Man, so have you ran into a lot of women, Black women that's in the industry?
I haven't. I know one here in New York. She's like a powerhouse. I know some of the people she works with upstate as well. Her brand is called Illmatic. So I know Candace. I know another young lady in Atlanta. She has a spa. It's called Canna B Spa. She actually services a few reality stars down there. Who else do I know in the industry? That's really it, honestly. So no, there's not a lot of us. We're coming up now because we're starting to understand the benefits and the price margins and profit margins. We're starting to understand it. So we're getting there. We're getting there.
Hey, you know what I was just thinking while you was talking and how we were saying they're taking their time with legalizing it across the board because they're trying to figure out how they can get the big money. I also think Big Pharma is stopping cannabis from being legal. Because I think like if people were smoking cannabis and doing the topicals, it'll hit Big Pharma real bad.
Yeah.
Right. So whereas, you know, you are a chemotherapy patient and they give you these pills after you take the chemotherapy, but instead of you taking those pills, you smoke something.
Yeah.
It'll hurt Big Pharma.
Yeah. So you have, I mean, you can get a medical marijuana card for a lot of different things now. My best friend is actually a nurse practitioner and she's actually certified to give medical cards.
What?
Yeah. And that's the other way. If you're going to open a dispensary, one of the easiest ways is to get a nurse practitioner on board who is certified to give out those type of licenses.
Okay. I knew a guy who was in the VA and he had some type of illness where the military sent him a canister of marijuana every month.
Wow. Like, wow.
Every month.
So the issue with Big Pharma is, like you stated, number one, them getting a hold of it, right? Because we know once Big Pharma gets a hold of certain things, we really don't know how much it gets manipulated and tampered with. Mm-hmm. So that's the first issue, is making sure that the product is still pure once Big Pharma decides they want to put their hand in this puzzle, which I do see that happening, because a lot more people are becoming conscious of what they take, natural and holistic things. We even have like hemp. We can't call them cigarettes because we don't ever want to compete with the cigarette company. So we call them smokes. But hemp smokes can actually help wean people off of regular cigarettes because it tastes like a cigarette. It smokes like a cigarette, but there's no nicotine in it. It's all hemp. So it's actually a cleaner version of a cigarette. So I do believe Big Pharma will try to jump on having certain products, but how well they will work, now that part I don't know. That part I don't know. But it definitely would put a damper in their pockets. Absolutely. Absolutely.
I mean, because it'll cure a lot of stuff.
Yes. And that's the other thing. So when you're on, so CBD, like the cream, yes, that does work quickly because it's a topical. But if it's like, let's say you have Crohn's, right? Crohn's disease. So Crohn's disease, you could take a tincture, which is an oil that goes under your tongue. You let it sit and it dissolves into your bloodstream. And you can swallow the rest of it because it's completely safe. So something like that, yes, with Crohn's, if you're having a flare-up, you will feel it. But in order to really see great effects, you need to add it into your routine, right? Because it needs to become something that's consistent. And your body actually can build up a tolerance to certain CBD as well as anything, right? If you use something daily, it can build up a tolerance for it. And then all you do is you come back down off of it and then you go back into it, or you find a different potency for it. You can do that as well. But
though, I think that's with any medication though.
Yeah, like, that's with anything. So you just want to be careful with that. But yes, it's very interesting to see what's going on with Big Pharma, because there are so many of us that understand treatment versus cure. And we understand that they don't promote cures, they promote treatment. So I'm going to be, it's interesting to see where it's going to go. I'm hoping they don't put their hand in it too much, because then it'll just turn into a straight SHIT show.
Listen though, Jasmine, you hoping for the wrong thing. Right, because if they got more, they got money to go buy acres of land, like hundreds of land. Like
the reason why it would stink for the small businesses is because they would knock you right out, and you can't compete. You can't compete price wise with what they can do. So that would be an issue. Like I said, the potency, the purity of it, you don't know what they would be undercutting your products with as well. So, yeah, that's a difficult one. I tell people, listen, ride the wheels while you can.
Right, because they're gonna get into it. They are going to get into that industry, and it's gonna be crazy. So with what is your brand?
So my brand is called Highly Sedity, and it's really a brand where I wanted to make, I mean, we service men, women, if your child needs the gummies or anything like that, we service them as well. But I'm really big on women indulging. And because for years it was seen like not a ladylike thing to do. And it was like, oh my God, like you smoke, like, whoa, right? So I wanted to make it, because I know women who buy more product than most men. Okay. I know women who have a smoke session before they go out with their girlfriends, right? So I got to the point where I wanted it to be okay to indulge. I wanted it to be okay to still be feminine. I wanted it to be okay to be dainty, and you don't have to burn your nails, and you know, you don't have to be ashamed of how you're pulling up. Like I even have like these lighters, which are like encased in like crystals. Because I wanted to make it cute, right? For women. So that's where the Highly Sedity name of it came from.
Okay. So do you have good product?
I do. And that's one of the reasons why I wanted to be on the farm. So I understood where the product was coming from. I understood potency. I wanted to make sure things were pure. So we have a manufacturer in Ohio where you name it, we do it. We have bath salts, bath bombs, massage oil, tinctures, gummies, facial cream, all kinds of things.
So you ship the flower to them, and then they extract the oils to make all your different things, right?
Yes. So to make the product. And then they're also attached to another reputable farm as well. So God forbid, because like I said, we are here in New York. That was the other reason why we decided to go that route with the manufacturer. Because God forbid something happens to our crops here, I would be out of product. So I needed to make sure that I was attached to another reputable farm to where they're able to produce things on their end if in case anything happens on our side.
So, you know, you should reach out to Mike Tyson.
So it's funny. I love Vegas. And the last time I was there, I was supposed to go to the Mike Tyson dispensary, and I don't know what happened. If I could get in touch with Mike Tyson, I would love to. Yeah. He has a I wanted to go visit it because I also like meeting other people that understand farming or that are just on the land and the space. So we didn't get a chance to go visit his facility, but I believe I'm going back in a couple months. So hopefully I get to visit when I'm there.
Now, how do you get your own strain?
So it's actually not as hard as people think. Okay. I know somebody here in New York who is 22 who is developing his own strain. And it's called Doobie Boys or Doobie Cakes. I know the first name is Doobie. So it's literally just a matter of testing the product, right? So you want to connect yourself with a farm that grows THC, and then whether they crossbreed or, you know, however they do it, you work with somebody that's a cultivator and you're going to go over the terpenes. So what do you want it to taste like and things like that? And then they'll recommend a strain that already has those qualities. So like they'll take two strains and put them together and grow and see how that grows. Right. Mm-hmm. And then once they see how it grows, they will decide, like, you can actually tell the color that a bud is going to turn, like how people like purple haze and it's actually like hints of purple. So you can actually tell what color a bud is going to turn by the stem on the plant. So some buds you could tell will be a more reddish color, a little orangey and things like that. But it's not that hard. So it's licensing. It's licensing, patience, and time. Because you got to see how the buds will come once they crossbreed.
Now, once you crossbreed those buds, right? Do you get seeds? Or y'all hydroponically?
No, so you can get the seeds, and then when you get the seeds, then you keep going, or you can get clones.
If it's a female seed, right?
Yes. And okay, yes. Seed. So there's a whole science to seeds.
Right.
There's a whole science to plants. Plants are very temperamental, like people. Mm-hmm. So if you ever see, like, if you go on my Instagram, Haile Sadidi LLC, in Instagram, you'll see like there's video footage of me on the farm, and there is one piece of footage. There's a bucket with yellow leaves in it. Mm-hmm. Those leaves are in what we call distress. So there are seeds that can be, I mean, not seeds. There are plants that can be saved once their leaves turn yellow, but it depends on the environment that the plant is in. It depends on why is your plant in distress. But plants tell you a lot about themselves.
Nice.
But they're temperamental.
Wiz Khalifa got his own strain, right? It's like it's his own strain, yes, or whatever.
Did you know Steve Urkel has his own strain?
Steve Urkel has a, do we call it Steve Urkel?
It's called Purple Urkel.
Wow.
It's called Purple. It just dropped like maybe 2.5 months ago or so. But yeah, Steve Urkel is in the cannabis industry, and like heavy in the cannabis industry. Like Snoop Dogg was talking about his strain.
That it was that good?
Yeah.
Snoop Dogg?
It was that good.
Strain was that good? Snoop Dogg does probably smoke every strand that there is. Are you frozen?
Are Thank coming out that they like, that they endorse cannabis or that they're a fan of it. So yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
Mayweather has a I don't know if it's his line or he just endorses it or whatever, but he has a line of CBD products as well. Yeah.
Wow.
There's so many celebrities getting into it.
And if you get a good strand, then dispensaries all over going to be trying to get you in their store, right? Like, how does that work?
So if you develop your own strain, you can approach a dispensary about putting your strain in there, because there's so many of them. You just have to be very fluid with the breakdown of the strain. So how potent is the strain? You have to have a COA attached to everything. Things have to be lab tested if they're going into a dispensary as well. So you want to make sure that you are connecting with a lab for, because, you know, they want to make sure that your product is a good product to put in. But if you went that route, it's just a matter of contacting the dispensary. But also understand that when the demand shows up, you have to be able to meet the demand. So if the dispensary needs a certain amount, you want to be able to produce that.
Okay, so let's say this. Let's say I am a farmer and I send something to a dispensary, but it doesn't sell. And how long do the dispensaries keep that jar or whatever, and it doesn't sell?
So usually the jars are in airtight sealed jars. They're smell proof as well. That when you go to dispensaries, the jar really is supposed to have an expiration date or a use by date on it to get the best quality. Now, even if your bud dries up, you can still use it and it'll still get you where you're trying to go. It just won't be as potent. It starts to lose its potency just a little bit. But there are so many different ways to preserve, but you can actually put it in the freezer as an amazing way to preserve it, and it stays moist. You can actually use a tortilla shell, mm-hmm. like that for like sandwich wraps and things like that. I prefer the spinach ones because it's really, really moist. And you can stick that in, like, let's say you have let's say you have a half pound or even an ounce. You can actually put the tortilla shell in the bag, in a Ziploc bag, and seal that up. Let it sit for about a day. It'll get your buds moist again, and then throw them right in the freezer, and they're good. That's before it gets to the dry out stage, though. And you can manipulate the taste of your buds as well. I'll tell you guys that secret. I'm just giving y'all all my secrets. You can manipulate the taste of the buds as well. If you took an orange peel, peppers, lemon peels, limes, and you put that in a Ziploc bag with the buds. You let that sit for a day or two and you throw it in the freezer. It'll change. It can change the taste of the buds as well.
Wow. You are really Griselda. You know everything. Oh.
I gave y'all some of my top-notch secrets this evening.
We already talked about it, but you need a show.
I'm not sure.
Because what? My thing is this. People are so afraid of cannabis because it was illegal, right? Like, it was illegal. But it, to me, it was no different than prohibition, right? And when they had prohibition, what did you see a rise in? They drank more, mm-hmm. and you saw a rise in crime, right? Because if I got to do stuff underneath the table or underneath the radar, And I'm making pretty good money, I'm not going to let you mess that up. Right. Like I'm not going to let you mess up. So, but as soon as, and I read this too, when prohibition was over with, right, they did a stat. And even though now you can drink freely, it wasn't any more people drinking after prohibition as it was before prohibition, right? The same amount of people were drinking. But during prohibition, they put fear in the public by saying if we make it legal, everybody's gonna be getting drunk. Everybody just right. gonna be right, you know. And that wasn't the case. Like that wasn't the case. And I think for me, I think people gravitate to whatever it is they gravitate to.
Yes.
And legal or not.
Yes and no. So the reason I'll say, now I agree with you on one hand, and the only reason I'm going to disagree is because they told the world and society, told all of us that it was illegal and you shouldn't use it and things like that. You have more elders
indulging, right? Because what happens is, let's say your kid uses it, and your kid is like, no, mom, I'm telling you, you should try it and see. And let's say your mom has a bad hip. She got arthritis. And you roll her a spliff, and now mom uses it, and she kind of likes it. Because the government told mom it's okay now. So you do have more, but depending on the generation. The younger kids, absolutely not. They were going to indulge no matter what the situation, right? But the older generation who was like gung-ho on this is wrong, it's not cool, don't do it. Say no to drugs and all this other craziness because it's not even a drug anymore. But those same people are now becoming fans of it and understanding. Because not to be funny, but if I do like the farmer's market or certain pop-up shops that aren't geared towards younger people, all of the older people know about CBD and hemp and the benefits of it.
Do you grow a personal plant at home?
I don't. I don't. You know why? I don't have the time to nurture it. And you have to have a controlled environment, and you have to have space for the plant to grow and things. So I don't have the space for it. The space or the time to really nurture it. And then like I get stuff by the pound. So I had some CBD in my freezer that I had forgot about, and I was like cleaning it out and doing my normal monthly cleaning. And I'm like, oh man, I forgot. And it was literally a half a pound. So there's CBD all over the place with me. So
okay, on the farm, right? This is, I always been curious because I've never really actually seen a plant in person. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I ain't never seen a marijuana plant, right? I've seen it on TV and all that. So I'm curious. One plant could yield how much flower?
And as far as in weight, because that's the only real way that you could weigh it, right?
Yeah, so in weight,
depending on the size of the plant, but you normally about a half a pound. It depends. Now, it also depends on how good one plant, but it also depends on your drying process and how good the trimming is. So what happens is, and I have a video that shows that too on my Instagram. So there's a whole drying process. So the way that the drying process works is once it comes off and it's dry, the plant is dried out, we have to then do what's called trimming. So now you can have machine trim or you can do hand trimming. Now hand trimming, sometimes you can recoup more product, but it takes a lot longer than machine trim. So that depends on that part as well. How good are the people that are trimming your flower?
Okay.
Because the way it comes in the bud, that ain't how it comes off the plant.
Yeah, that's what I was saying, because you know,
but it can be considered a half of a pound, because you got to remember you're pulling all of that off until you trim. So now once you trim, now we have to see how much is left from the trimming. Okay, but like there's a greenhouse up there that's actually worth $11 million. It has $11 million worth of plants in it.
$11 million worth of plants.
$11 million worth of plants. And then you also have to remember certain strains go for more money than other strains.
Yeah, that's what I'm going to say too, right? But how do you do, how is that though? Like,
it's the same thing as THC. So the more potent it is, the more money it costs. So like you can get what we would call Reggie in the urban community, right? That's like bogus weed, or some people call it CBD. So that's cheaper. So by the pound, the lower grade you're gonna get for maybe $800, and then the higher the grade, the more money. So if you're talking about getting something really worth having, you're talking $2,400 and better a pound. Yeah, and but that's for THC. Now CBD is a lot. There's a whole different price margin where CBD actually. CBD usually can run anywhere between $300 and $400 a pound, and then CBG runs about $600 to $1,000 a pound, depending on the strain.
Hey, you know what I think they're doing on the streets now, though, Jazz? I think they buy CBD.
So I've heard that. So here's
a little bit of good stuff,
trick to that though that a lot of people won't tell you is if you actually mix CBD with THC, it actually increases the THC. So if you mix CBD with THC, it's a more potent high, but it can't be like 90% CBD and 10% THC. It can't be that. But I have heard that on the streets as well, because you also have to remember a lot of our strains are the same exact strains of THC. So it looks the same, it smells the same, it's gonna smoke the same, but it, you know, usually doesn't hit as hard if it's just CBD. But yeah, I'm sure of it. I am sure of it.
Now, potency. How is potency regulated? Like, how do you?
So potency, like, has to be regulated in a lab. They have like machines now that can regulate them, but I'm not going to hold you. I wouldn't be too, I'm not sure how effective those machines are. Cause I know somebody who supposedly he was like testing his product and the machine said like potency undetectable. So in his mind, he was like, oh, this is like off the Richter. And when I tried it, I was like, this ain't it.
No, it wasn't no potency in it. That's why I wasn't.
Right. And I was just like, I'm not sure about that machine. But usually that's on your COA as well. So, and then if you get into the industry, your COA is kind of like your get out of jail free card. If you're into CBD and you're mailing it, you have to mail all loose flower with a COA, to protect yourself and your consumer. God forbid the post office flags it, which the post office does have a hemp agreement with the hemp industry. So you can mail CBD with the post office without it being an issue, but God forbid it was to get flagged, your COA inside the packaging is what will notify them that, hey, I know this looks like cannabis, but it's not. It's actually CBD.
You already know what people are going to be doing.
Of course. But that's the other side of it, to where you can't get around that. You knew that was going to happen. So.
Right. Like that, like, you know, because when I was in Connecticut, I used to, well, my homeboy's in Connecticut now, and he want to get in the CBD industry. And I was like, well, like, where you going to get your flowers from? He said, man, don't worry about it. I get mine from Cali. I'm like, Cali? He said, yeah, you want me to send you some cookies? I say, no. Not send me no cookies. No. You getting it from, and I was scared because I didn't know what you just told me, that, you know, the post office, the U.S. post office has an agreement with the hemp industry. Yeah. I'm thinking like, nah, somebody knocking, we got a package for you. No, you ain't got no package for me.
Yeah. So they, and that was in like the past, I don't know if it's been a whole year that they've had that contract, but. Or that agreement. But yeah, it's actually that I provide all of that to my affiliates. Like, they're able to print all of that out when they ship their stuff to make sure that they're covered.
So with your affiliates, you train them to make product out of the flower? Like,
yeah, so they can either make the product themselves or they can just get it straight from my manufacturer. Our manufacturer also offers drop shipping. So they never even have to have the product on hand if they choose not to. Everything is certified. The manufacturer is licensed as well to make sure that everybody's covered when it comes to paperwork.
And you know what? And you know what's crazy that I like about the industry is that it's one of those resources that ain't never going nowhere.
Yeah.
Like, it ain't, you can't deplete it. Like, it's never going anywhere.
It's not. Now, the issue is, so one of the major issues in the industry is banking, like I was saying before. So you have to be very careful. Square is one of the payment processing systems that we can use. They do have a CBD clause. You just have to upload. They might ask you for some COAs and things like that, and you can upload that. That's probably the only... Well, not, let me not say the only, that's one of the only payment processing systems. They have a lot more on the West Coast. That's another thing. If our melanin people can figure out a payment processing system to get people.
It ain't really figuring it out though, Jan. It's just the federal government haven't legalized it yet. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
right. But like, you can't sell CBD using like Stripe. You really shouldn't use it with PayPal. So being that Square is one of the most popular ones that allow it, if we were able to pick something else, like if we were able to design something, that would be major. Even if we designed a platform where people were actually able to promote their product without being censored or without being flagged, that would be a game changer in this industry. And when I tell you guys, it wouldn't just be our people that would use the platforms. Believe me on that, because everybody in this industry, I don't care, black, white, purple, green, everybody's looking for the next thing to jump on so that they can get their product out there.
Well, like, I can understand why Square do it, because Square's, like, Square and Cash App, do you know what bank that they're associated with?
I just found that out, but refresh me.
It's called Sutton Bank.
Yes.
It's called Sutton. No, I never heard of this bank before in my life. Never, ever. I looked for a brick and mortar Sutton Bank. Can't find it.
Oh, wow. I've heard that.
You can't find it. There's no brick and mortar Sutton Bank. So that leads me to say that ain't no Sutton Bank. Square is Sutton Bank. It's Sutton Bank. And because if you notice, the reason why you can use Square is because it ain't FDIC insured. Your money is not FDIC insured with Square.
That's a fact. And a lot of people don't know that. And a lot of people don't know that Square can, because this happened to me. It didn't happen with this business, but it happened with my, I have an adult toy store as well. So this happened with that business. So I made some good money, and Square froze my account and told me, this was back in September, and told me I couldn't get my money till December of this year. And I was like, absolutely not. So I had to refund everybody and then go back and try to recoup that sale through PayPal. But yeah, and Square has the authority to freeze your account and tell you it's non-negotiable, it's non-debatable, like this is the final decision. And I've even had people that I know in business who Square froze their account. They waited, you know, the 2.5 months, 3 months. And when Square released their money, they didn't release all of their money. I've seen that happen too.
Listen. Somebody hacked my account.
Oh my gosh.
I tap now. I don't insert. I don't slide. I tap everything, right? But it was only like $1,600. I'm saying only. It was $1,600.
Right.
Right. Like, it was $1,600. And Square saw how the man was, whoever it was, was just trying to drain my account. They did one transaction for $500, another one for $500, then another one for $300, and then another one for $100, and then they went back and tried to go another $1,600, and just so happened that I had transferred a lot of money out of my Square account to my bank. So they refunded me the two smaller amounts. They refunded me and told me that they resolved the issue by November. It's like this month, November, this month, they're going to resolve the issue. And I'm like, wait a minute. Not only am I a customer, but I use Square for my business. And you're telling me that you're not going to resolve this issue for 2 months. So what I start doing now, every week, I cash out.
Yeah.
I cash out.
Yeah, and I tell people that too. I definitely recommend that. I wasn't even able to cash out. Like, somebody had posted my website and the post went viral. It has like over 1 million views. And they literally froze my account in less than 48 hours. Like, that's how much money had been generating. They was like, yeah. And then at first I thought it was just a flag. And then it was like, yeah, we decided to close your account.
Square?
This was Square. Yep. So I left it alone. I know a lot of these payment processing services are becoming really strict on what they allow. I've seen people that own clothing stores, wig companies, cosmetics, their stuff has gotten frozen as well.
Why? Because they can.
Because they can, right, exactly. And like the reason that we've all come to is the conclusion they give all of us for the most part is like, oh, they just don't support what you sell. But then you're like, but you did support it beforehand. So, and like I said, there's no warning or any, like I literally just looked up, I went to cash my money out of Square because I believe in cashing out quickly. Mm-hmm. And they were like, yeah, we froze your account. So.
And then it's hard to get somebody to talk to.
Oh, please forget it. Forget it. Trying to get somebody on the phone with them is a whole headache. They were still sending me representative like emails, like the help from the chat and all of that. They were still sending me that after they had denied the account. And I was like, for what? I don't want to talk to you now. It was, you told me it's non-negotiable. We have nothing to talk about. So I tell any entrepreneurs, I don't care what you sell, be up to date on all of your stuff. I'm not really a fan of PayPal, but what I will say is if you get the PayPal debit card, allow your money to just go right onto there. And it minimizes you having too many issues.
Now, PayPal got me too.
PayPal got me too. I actually have to go to court behind somebody who tried to fight me with PayPal, and they won. They lost all of their disputes with PayPal. I won every single dispute, and she was upset. She was trying to be a part of my affiliate program. I don't know what she thought, but she thought after like 2.5 months, I was just going to give her back her money when you've already had access to all of my documents. Like, that's not how this works. So we gotta go to court at some point when the courts fully open back up, but it's a part of business.
PayPal got me. Well, it wasn't PayPal. It was more so a customer just like you. He did an order. You know, I'm a graphic designer. Mm-hmm. So he did an order for $3,500, but he was going to be out of town. Right. And he wanted me to ship his order to somebody else. Right, like, right, because he's gonna be out of town. Uh-huh. Cool, it's cool. I mean, I done got paid already. I've gotten paid already, right? So I shipped it. He even called me and told me, yeah, my people's got it. Thank you, bro, blah, blah, blah. Uh-huh. Then a week later, he goes and disputes the charge.
With PayPal,
right? PayPal froze my account. Now, if you ain't got no money in your PayPal, they go to your bank account.
Yes, they sure do.
They go to your bank account and get that money, right? So they went in my bank account, got $3,500 and refunded him and said, well, you know, through this process. And the only reason why he won is because the address that I shipped it to wasn't his address.
Oh my gosh.
That I shipped it to wasn't his address. I should have recorded him asking me.
Yeah, or had him send a text message.
Or something, right? Something.
Wow.
So
that's so unfortunate.
I was peed off, but I was like, you know, this is the cost of doing business. You gotta be right.
And it's a lesson learned. And so many people, when it comes to business, I know if you're like me, you're fixated on getting things right, but this literally is a learning lesson as you go. So, and listen, you win some, you're going to lose some, you're going to recoup a whole lot. You know, there's so many different ups and downs to this that, social media doesn't show what happens. You know, I've had people try to scam me out of money. Oh, please. All types of stuff in business.
That's what any business, right?
Yeah.
It's just with the cannabis industry blowing up like that, like you're going to have, I call them, you're going to have a lot of quote unquote Ghana people. Mm-hmm. you know, you're going to have a lot of people that's going to be selling you dreams, and not able to produce. But they, it's almost like you mentioned a MLM, right? You remember Five Links?
Yes, I do.
Remember Five Links? Now, they had a concept of the video phone. They showed you, remember they had that video phone that you can call?
Uh-huh.
The video, it looked good. The prototype, right? Everything was good. I ain't never seen the video phone in person.
Yeah, no. Right?
I never seen it. And then about 3 years after its inception, I see a documentary on them, and it was a scam. Five Links was a scam. And I mean, they had people from New York to Atlanta.
Yes.
And because I'm always weary about any business, right? I'm always weary about any business that you're telling me you're a multi-billion dollar, you're in a multi-billion dollar industry, you're a multi-billion dollar company, but I ain't seen one commercial. You ain't never seen one Five Links commercial.
Yeah, that's very true. I've actually had people ask me, am I going to turn Haile Sidibe into an MLM company? And I said, absolutely not. If it was structured something similar, possibly, but it would just be in each region that we have, that we reach. You know, there might be a top earner or like a supervisor, but that's it. It wouldn't be like you got to bring this person in their back office and sign this person up. I don't want to deal with that. I don't want the stress or the headaches. I'm not going to say MLMs don't work because I've seen people work the system, but it's not for me and my company. Like, that's not what I want. And I'm sure the company's going to grow. I have 14 affiliates now, and I am literally at like their beck and call. Like, they can call me, they can text me, and we're spread out. Some of us are in Arizona, New York, Atlanta, Philly. We're kind of all over Florida. So, you know, for me, it's 9 o'clock here, but in Arizona, it's 12 o'clock. I mean, it's 12 o'clock here, but it's 9 o'clock there. So I'm always on the go. I'm always on the phone. There is no like, okay. I mean, I do sleep, but there's always a constant. So, yeah.
Well, tell the people if they want to be, or first of all, let me say this. I wouldn't do an MLM on your company, but I would do franchising.
So I actually know somebody who has a donut company here in New York, and he's getting ready to franchise his company. So I am going to pick his brain and talk about some stuff as far as franchising goes. When we get to that step, because I'm at the point now where I'm only going to open my affiliate program for a limited time each year. So that way I can work with my new affiliates, keep my old affiliates on track, because it does take a lot of work. And then I'm actually opening a store here in New York. I haven't set an official launch date, but I do believe we will softly be open by next week. So
nice.
Thank you. But it's a lot, and we've grown, because I've only had Haile Sidibe for a year, literally. Mm-hmm. But things just took off so crazy. And even with the Black Farmer, I wasn't supposed to have my own company. He actually wanted me to come on as like a brand ambassador for his company. When he realized all of the stuff I knew, he was like, nah, you got to start your own. Like, I've never met a Black woman who knew this much. So he helped walk me through those steps. But yeah.
Okay. So tell the people how they can find you.
Sure. I am on all platforms at Haile Sidibe LLC. That's on Instagram. That's on YouTube. We have a YouTube page. I got to just upload more stuff. And that's on Facebook as well. Okay. Oh, and you can find me at HaileSidibeLLC@gmail.com. If you want to email us, if you want to contact us via phone, it is 718-200-6462.
Well, I will put your contact information on both of my pages, right?
Okay, thank you.
Is the affiliate program open right now for new affiliates?
So we actually just closed the program at the beginning of October. We closed it down. So we will be coming back next year, just because I need everybody to close out their books properly for this year. Mm-hmm. I do have an affiliate who just started her own she got her first shipment of all of her own products as well. So we're excited for her. So we will be opening back up next year. I'm projecting probably around March. I'll open it up and I'll leave it open till probably June or July, and then I'll close it back down so that I can fully work with everybody.
Well, Jazz, if you definitely open my eyes to the cannabis industry. I'm well informed, right? Like now it's like, God. when you look at an industry, you don't like, okay, a Snicker bar. You just know it tastes good. You don't know how it got to be the way that it is. Uh-huh. Right? Like the intricacies of the amount of caramel, the amount of chocolate, all that, you know.
It's very strategic. Very strategic. Right.
And that's what I was saying. So with you being on the, first of all, I commend you for wanting to see, you know, the beginning of the process, which is the flower and where it comes from, right? Mm-hmm. I commend you for that. Because most people, you know, if they making some butter or, you know, and all that, they don't care. Just give me some flour. Like, I don't care about that. Just give me some. And I wanted to ask you, do you have an extractor in your house? Like,
so no. So I actually am very old school with it because I just feel like it makes more sense for me to do it that way. For now, maybe I'll get into the whole machine. I know I do have one of my affiliates has an extractor machine. And she said it kept rendering a burnt smell because you have to watch your flower. It takes a while to extract oil, but you do have to watch it to make sure that your buds don't burn as well, because then you'll get a burning smell with your oils.
How do you extract it? I'm trying to figure out, like how do you get oil from, is it a press? Like, I know.
No, olive. So what you do is the old school way is with a crock pot and a carrier oil. And all you're going to do is you figure out which carrier oil you're going to use. Sometimes we use olive oil for some stuff. Some stuff we do use coconut oil. And then some stuff we use MCT oil as well, which is like a coconut based oil. You use that as your carrier, and then you put the oil and your flour in a crock pot and you let it cook for a little while, and then you're gonna extract it with a cheesecloth. It's messy. I'm not gonna lie, it's really messy. This is also why our manufacturer provides tinctures for you, massage oil and some other stuff, because it gets messy. It's tedious if you're not into doing it, because what you think is a lot, it'll only be 16 ounces. But in your mind, you're like, dang, I worked for that 16 ounces, you know. Right. So, but I do teach how to do it on your own, just in case. Like, my mom always extracts her own oil. She doesn't use our manufactured oil.
Oh, okay. Well, Jazz, it's been great.
Yes, thank you so much. And I just, one last thing I do want to say is, I don't ever want money to just be the motive, but I do want people to understand how good the money is here, right? So I had an affiliate who COVID hit, because again, I started this in the midst of COVID. COVID hit and she became an affiliate, one of my very first affiliates, and she actually created a COVID kit that has CBD stuff in it, sea moss, vitamins, herbs, turmeric, all kind of stuff, right? She sold this kit and made $10,000 in 3 months.
What?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Nah. Wait a minute, though. But you know what, though? Because of where you are and because of the density of where you are.
But she's not from New York.
Where's she from?
She's from Philly. She's not from New York.
Same thing.
So, right, but like, she was able to get it because, you know, at that time, people were in a frenzy and the health, and I want to be all natural and holistic. And right. She coined. And I, you know, like I was telling her, and I mean, she had just a basic kit. And I was like, you could even broke that down even further. You could have did kits for kids, fit kits for pregnant women, kits for people with osteoporosis. Like, there's so many different realms she could have gone. Which I do teach my affiliates as well, is breaking stuff down. I give them some of my gym ideas because I'm not ever going to bring it to fruition. But please, please, please consider getting into the industry if this is something that you're really into, if it's something that you want to learn more on. Please do figure out, go and research the endocannabinoid system. That will tell you a lot about CBD and how CBD affects your endocannabinoid system. Yeah, just get into it. I can't, and don't just watch YouTube videos because some of them can be boring. I'm not gonna lie. Some of them are like a snooze fest. But get into the industry if you possibly can. That way we can't talk about not being in it to win it. You know what I'm saying? Because sometimes we're so right. frustrated as a people, we get to everything at the last minute and we've missed out on the real good money. Yeah, they gave you a little bit of money, but we want the good money.
Okay. Okay. Well, just like it was a custom for me to ask you two questions at the beginning of the show, also, it's also a custom for me to ask you a couple of questions at the end of the show.
Okay.
All right. What are you doing to push the culture forward?
I am all about my people, right? Like, I'm blackity blackity black, as light skinned as I am, right? I do so many different things. So I do have the CBD industry and I help other black people get into the industry baseline. And you can create your own product and push your own product, because I don't want you only pushing my stuff. Push your own stuff, because when I get to the top, because I'm getting there, I don't want to be friends, and no offense to them, with the Kardashians, right? Because they weren't checking for me in this tax bracket. So don't come check for me when I get to yours. That's number one. Number two, I used to be a part of a program called the Top Teens of America. They asked me to come back. I'm actually now the president of that chapter. So I do a lot of community service with my kids. We do mentoring. Aside from the cannabis and the toy industry, I also do sisterhood retreats called You Can Sit With Us. My mom is hella successful. And that literally is what it is. Every time my mom establishes herself, whether it's career-wise, education, an organization, once she solidifies her place at the table, she invites me to come sit down. And I think that's how legacy gets started. And I believe that that's the path we have to take back, getting back to sisterhood. So the program is called, the event is called You Can Sit With Us. And that's literally what it is. I provide a seat for you at the table. We eat, we chop it up. We do some healing, some cleansing. Like, it's a whole all around effect. So I'm all about my people and pushing it forward. I support small black owned businesses. I don't care if you don't even get it right the first time. I'll still come back and shop with you because I need you to get it right. You know, I'm one of those people. So I'm all in with my community. I love my people.
Okay. Since you love your people so much, the next question should be easy. I need for you to name me three famous or important black people, but they can't be athletes or entertainers.
Three important black people: W.E.B. Du Bois, Dick Gregory. Dang, a third person. I had those two quick. My mama, Dr. Alicia Cross. Let's get that.
I ask people that question because, like, three important black people who are not, you know, athletes or entertainers, they should come off our head like that, right?
It should. Right.
But we're not taught like that in school. No. We're not, you know, so. But you said W.E.B. Du Bois. See, I'm not a fan of Du Bois. I'm
just going to.
No. You see who I got on my wall?
I do. Frederick Douglass. Malcolm X, and is that Medgar Evers? What? No, you, who's yeah. that? Who's the other? I can't really see that picture too well.
You missed the main one, like the most important one.
Who's that?
You don't know who that is? Are you from New York? And wait a minute, not only are you from
New York. I'm sure when you say it, I'm be like, oh, who is that?
You're from New York, but you said you're from Harlem, right?
No, I'm from Queens.
Queens? Okay. That's Marcus Garvey.
Ah, okay.
And the reason why,
but
here's the reason why I don't like Du Bois. You know, him and Du Bois had beef.
I've heard about that. I have to read up on that.
Yeah, not beef in a sense that they didn't like each other. Ideology, what Du Bois thought, you know, black people needed versus what Marcus thought black people needed. So, but. I love Dick Gregory. I think David Chappelle is the modern day Dick Gregory.
Yes. I wish more people would get into Dick Gregory. Because his brain will take you someplace.
Yeah, but
his brain will take you someplace that you never thought that way or to go that way.
Yeah, but his delivery system is crazy though. The way he delivers his message, it's just not it's the truth what he says, a lot of stuff that he said, it'd be the truth, but the way he deliver it, right? Yeah. Like it's just really, and I understand him delivering that way, because if you look at young Dick Gregory, he wasn't that rambunctious when he did his jokes. He was cool. I mean, same jokes, he was Paul Mooney cool.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah, he was cool, but as he got older, he got grouchy, and I think he's saying, wake up, you know?
Yes. That is exactly the tone of when he speaks is, do you not see it? Do you not get it? That's the exact tone.
Right, and you know, it's also one of those things like, you know, you're so important to the black community and you're a force in the black community, but ain't nobody ever tried to assassinate you.
Yes.
You understand what I'm saying?
He
like, ain't no
force to be reckoned with, and the veils that he lifted, right? Just from him just giving logic and telling people, think about it this way. And I think he really changed my way of thinking. I actually had the pleasure of meeting him while I was at Howard. And he did like a seminar or something. And I was very close-minded when I first got to college. That's just the way I was raised, right? My parents were very close-minded individuals. So sitting through a seminar that he did, it allowed me to change my trajectory and change the way I thought about things to where it was like, wait, but what if it was this? And I think that's important. And I think that's important just in life, but it's helped me in business because I'm able to always pivot my mindset to where black people will complain about gentrification. But the reality is white people aren't really moving into our community because it's a black and white thing. It's a money thing. It's money. That's it. They're following the money. It literally has nothing to do with our skin color in our community. And if we owned more of the community, they wouldn't be able to just come in and infiltrate. But that's a whole nother topic for another day. He allowed me to change my thinking pattern. And I can respect anybody that can challenge me to change my thinking pattern. So
Dick Gregory is a force. Well, everyone, thank once again. Hold on, I gotta get to you. I actually went like 35 minutes over because of the technical difficulties that we had in the beginning, right?
Okay.
So I wanted to do the full interview, but I want to thank you.
Thank you. I appreciated this.
And we have a meeting scheduled for tomorrow, right?
Yes, sir.
We got a meeting scheduled for tomorrow. So I'll talk to you tomorrow. All and right. Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much. You. Good night.
Jasmine Cross.
Good night.
Bye-bye. So, learned a lot about the cannabis industry tonight. I've had another gentleman, Hokey. He's from Detroit, lives in D.C. He is I should have told her about Hoki because he has a channel on Roku that is dedicated just to the cannabis industry. And I think they need to meet each other. But thank everyone for joining me tonight, man. I went a little bit over because I was having technical difficulties in the beginning, but I appreciate everyone who stayed with me. And remember, in order for you to receive a blessing, you must first be a blessing. And with that, peace.